Well, good evening, everyone, and welcome. Thanks for joining us tonight for tonight's lung learning webinar for primary healthcare professionals. It's entitled The New Frontier, Post-Acute and Long COVID Care. My name is Andrew Knight. I've been in general practice for something like 35 years now, and currently I'm a staff specialist in southwestern Sydney at what's called the Primary and Integrated Care Unit. I've got a conjoint appointment at UNSW, and I'm also chair of NPS Medicine Wise at the moment, and I'm delighted to be here this evening. Through this virtual meeting place tonight, we're gathered from all over Australia. I gather over 600 people registered. So for myself, I'm sitting in a little place called Yumina on the central coast north of Sydney. It's the lands of the Gurungai people, and I want to take time to acknowledge them and to acknowledge all First Nations people from all around Australia, wherever you may be joining us from, at your home or your workplace. And I want to pay my respects to the traditional owners of country and acknowledge continuing connection to land, sea, community. I want to pay respects to elders, past, present, and emerging. This evening's session will focus on the clinical practice guidelines for post-acute COVID-19 and updates from the Australian COVID-19 Task Force, relevant to primary care community in managing long COVID. Before introducing the speakers for tonight, I just want to give you a little bit of housekeeping. First of all, I want to let you know that the session will be recorded and it's going to be available for viewing on demand. You'll receive an email with details to access the recording if you registered for the event, or you can register to get instant access to the on-demand version at any time after the session. After 3 months, the recording will then be hosted at the Lung Foundation Australia's YouTube channel and website. You'll notice there's a number of interactive features on the webinar console here, which we encourage you to make use of throughout tonight's cast. So, as I say them, I think they're going to highlight. So please access the group chat feature throughout the presentation to connect with your colleagues. In the resource hub, you'll find a number of links and documents relevant to tonight's topic. Or the membership box is there if you aren't yet a member of the Lung Foundation Australia. You'll also see a certification icon at the bottom of your screen. And about 45 minutes into the session, your certificate as evidence of attendance will be available for download. And I can confirm that this event is approved as a CPD activity with the RACGP for 2 points. The session will have an interactive Q&A format from the outset, so you're welcome and encouraged to submit your questions to the panel via the Q&A box. It's available throughout the webinar, so just feel free to ask questions as you go, questions, and directing it to the speakers for you. And there'll be a dedicated time after the first two presentations at the end of the session for a significant period of time. And I know a number of you have asked questions of the panel at registration, and hopefully you'll find the answers to these are covered in the content tonight, but we will ensure that they're asked on your behalf as well. So, so much for housekeeping. Now to the good bit, I'm going to introduce you to our expert panel. First of all, Professor Peter Wark. Peter is a senior staff specialist in respiratory and sleep medicine at John Hunter Hospital in Newcastle, conjoint professor at the University of Newcastle, senior member specialist of the Priority Research Centre for Healthy Lungs. He's a member of the Vaccines, Immunology, Viruses and Asthma Research Group at Hunter Medical Research Institute, and he's a member of TSANZ Executive Board and a chairman of the Clinical Care and Resources Subcommittee. So welcome, Professor Wark. And also joining us is Associate Professor Megan Rees. Megan is the interim head of the Department of Respiratory and Sleep Disorders Medicine at the Royal Melbourne Hospital and honorary clinical associate professor in the Department of Medicine at the University of Melbourne. Associate Professor Rees has a special interest in pulmonary infections and is a member of the Disease Modifying Treatment and Chemoprophylaxis Panel of the National COVID-19 Clinical Evidence Task Force. So welcome, Associate Professor Rees. So I'm now delighted to hand over to Professor Wark for the first presentation. Thanks, Peter. Take it away.
Thank you very much, Andrew, and thanks once again for the Lung Foundation inviting me to speak. I'm very happy to chat about post-acute sequelae with COVID-19. I think the New Frontiers title is very apt. I'm sure we all feel like we're moving into unknown territory with a little bit of, well, with a lot of trepidation and some concern as to how things are going to evolve, particularly given the current numbers that are out there with acute infection at the moment. I'm speaking to you tonight from the traditional lands of the Awabakal and the Wirumai people here in Newcastle, and would just like to acknowledge their elders past, present and current. So I'll base the first part of my talk actually on a draft clinical practice guideline for the assessment and management of adults with post-acute sequelae of COVID-19. So this is still in draft, though we're very, very nearly, hopefully, had this now approved. And this is a document that has been produced by New South Wales Health and the Agency for Clinical Innovation. We've had a lot of clinical practice guidelines and models of care that we have had to develop across New South Wales Health in somewhat warp speed. That's probably not the right term to use. It's Donald Trump's, isn't it? Anyway, we did it quickly. This is one of them. We still have some practical solutions, such as models of care, that we need to bring in, put into place here. But this is the start. So I'll just start with some very quick case definitions as to what we're talking about here and what stages of disease we're talking about. So we all know about acute COVID, and unfortunately most of us have got some experience with this now. And that's really the disease process up until the first 4 weeks. We know that people will experience symptoms for longer than that period of time, and we still have an important period between 4 and 12 weeks, but we really talk about post-acute sequelae. But this problem which persists beyond that 12 weeks, where terms such as long COVID and post-COVID start to become involved. So for no better reason than to have some consistency, we're adopted the definition that the World Health Organization has, and that's summarized here. Very arbitrarily, this is a condition that follows on from acute COVID-19. We're saying 3 months, again, just for consistency, from the onset of those acute symptoms and for symptoms which are persistent. Really, it's a diagnosis of exclusion of other active problems, but we're seeing quite a constellation of symptoms and signs. The evidence is definitely in evolution. This is very, very clinical, and at this stage, all of the world is starting to have to think about this and learn as to what this process is. There is research which is going on, but nearly all of the data that I will present tonight is pre-Omicron. And of course, we haven't had Omicron long enough for most patients to be moving into that post-acute phase beyond 3 months anyway. We know that post-acute COVID, the prevalence rates have varied enormously depending upon how you ascertain that. And there have been rates that have ranged from as high as from 43 to 63%, depending upon how you want to define that. We also feel fairly strongly that vaccination and milder illness seems to be having a protective effect. We know that people who develop post-acute syndrome with COVID-19 are also those who are most likely to have been most unwell during the acute phase of their illness. And this is a consistent finding. Yes, there are other people out there with very significant symptoms who did not have such a severe acute illness, but by and large, those with the greatest burden of illness following on from their acute diagnosis are those who had a very serious, severe acute diagnosis. So those who were in hospital, older individuals, those with pre-existing frailty and comorbidities. Obesity was a factor in severe acute disease and continues to be a factor in post-acute COVID. Prior vaccination consistently seems to be protective, as does prior exposure. And if you've got increased inflammatory markers, there's some emergence about biomarkers that might be helpful. And female sex seems to also be an independent factor. For those patients who do present to you following their acute COVID-19 diagnosis, there are some red flags that we want to highlight so that people are aware. Those with severe or new or worsening breathlessness really is a pause to consider what's going on and whether there's now an acute phenomenon, and I'll go into some of that briefly. Significant syncope, unexplained chest pain, particularly that which sounds like it's ischemic chest pain, is a real red flag for people to be aware of. And I'm sure many of you tuned into the Shane Warne Memorial last night. Ischemic heart disease is going to be a big factor in those recovering from COVID-19. Palpitations and arrhythmias occur similarly. And then, of course, the development of new focal neurological syndromes as well is a cause of concern. So why do people get ongoing problems? There is not going to be one single answer to this, and I'm not going to give it to you tonight either. We really do not know. This is really an area under very active evolution at the moment. There is organ dysfunction, which is a direct result of the acute illness, and we can understand that fairly clearly with acute pneumonitis and the fibrotic disease phase, which then occurs. We know that we're dealing with a significant vascular insult, which occurs both in the small and the large vessel level acutely, and that seems to translate to procoagulant states that linger for many, many months. We know that there are issues neurologically, both with hypoxia, vascular damage, and potentially direct neurological damage. There is significant physical deconditioning and impairment of muscles, and there is, of course, worsening of pre-existent medical and psychiatric and psychosocial problems as well. There is a myriad of causes, and there can be a myriad of causes in the patients that may present. So a clinical practice guideline really just outlines this problem. At this stage, it's not saying how we're going to deal with it, and it's a broad roadmap for New South Wales Health at the moment. The 10 most common symptoms that people will present with in this post-acute COVID phase, leading the way here is fatigue, particularly fatigue following exercise. Breathlessness, which I'll talk more on because really that's what I know something about. Cough is not uncommon. Depression, anxiety. Formal diagnoses such as PTSD also will feature. Significant cognitive impairment that impairs people's ability to function. Joint and muscle pain, mobility impairment, and I will touch upon ischemia and palpitations, as well as some other neurological symptoms such as loss of taste and smell. So we're still in a fairly acute phase here for most of us and most of the cases that are out there. And so people presenting soon after their acute illness with breathlessness is probably foremost in many people's minds at the moment, and certainly has been in my clinical practice. This is not an uncommon problem, particularly in patients that are hospitalized. Some series go up to a third to nearly a half of people will have lingering symptoms of breathlessness at the time of discharge and that persist. Though the good news is that for most of these individuals, it does improve. Again, the severity of the acute pneumonitis is probably the main driving factor here, whether there are any other acute complications during their time in hospital, and of course, the level of respiratory support, which is just a surrogate as to how sick they were and how badly their lungs were affected. So if you look, and this is a nice, fairly large meta-analysis that was published at the end of last year in JAMA. There are 38 studies that describe the presence of dyspnea in the post-acute COVID phase, that first 3 months following discharge. So you can see that it's a very common symptom and a very important one. Cough is also not uncommon, but probably won't have the same serious implications. And then when you dig in a bit further and look to see how many people have physiological lung impairment, you see things are a bit different. So breathlessness is very common. Pulmonary diffusion abnormalities that you could measure, such as using gas transfer, probably about a third, which is not too far off, those complaining of significant breathlessness, and very similar to the findings on high-resolution CT scan, where again, around about 20 to 30% will have findings such as ground glass infiltrates, interstitial changes. Spirometry with restriction, so a reduction in their forced vital capacity, is much less frequent and is associated with more severe impairment. Just to touch upon high-resolution CT scanning, if you go and do CT scans on many people who leave hospital who were admitted with acute COVID-19, you're going to find abnormalities. But this is not necessarily going to be a very helpful thing and is not something that I'm really recommending first up in terms of assessing people with breathlessness. So this is just an example from a nice publication here. This is a 46-year-old woman who was admitted with severe acute COVID-19. She required respiratory support, clearly, of course, got better. The first three slides along here were taken nearly a month after her acute symptoms, and you could see characteristic changes of ground glass infiltrates, some focal nodularity, and even some linear opacities and scarring. Day 198, you could see that the changes have gotten better. The ground glass is somewhat better. There's still some interstitial fibrosis and changes there, and even a little bit of honeycombing on this slice here. The problem is that does this functionally impair the individual? CT findings and abnormalities are going to be very common. If someone has a CT scan and they've had an acute admission with COVID-19, even those who were not that unwell quite possibly will have abnormalities early on. And this could generate lots of CT scans without a lot of help for those individuals. So the UK have taken more of a screening approach to this. This is a preprint publication from a cohort, the UK ILD study, really looking at a cohort of individuals with respiratory compromise and acute COVID to see who was at risk of going on and developing significant interstitial lung disease as a direct consequence of their acute COVID-19. So they've assembled over 3,000 patients and they've assessed them 240 days following their discharge. Now they began the assessment by asking people if they were breathless and doing a chest x-ray and measuring their gas transfer factor. They did spirometry as well, but as you've heard, vital capacity alone is just not sensitive enough. What they found was that an abnormal DLCO, less than 80% predicted, or abnormalities on chest x-ray was a pretty good guide that those people would have something interesting to find on a high-resolution CT scan. And so we would advocate at this stage an approach that took upon that sort of a screening approach before immediately going to high-resolution CT scans in everybody, because that will generate a lot of scans, a lot of abnormalities, and as you know, that will automatically mean lots of scans in follow-up to see what happens and what resolves of those changes. So this is the approach at the moment that we're recommending or planning to recommend, it's still in draft, about assisting someone with persistent breathlessness more than 4 to 8 weeks afterwards. If it's moderate to severe breathlessness, and we do give you some examples such as dyspnea 12 that you could use to assess severity, then do a chest x-ray, some spirometry and DLCO if that's available. Those who are milder though, we would recommend that they don't directly need investigations and you could refer directly to community physiotherapy or an exercise physiologist to get them to recover. In those who are more severe, we would recommend a more formal assessment and referral on to respiratory medicine where that's appropriate. And in those who've got significant impaired lung function, we are recommending at this stage pulmonary rehabilitation. They may well need further investigations, follow-up, and to see who will go on and develop persistent interstitial lung disease. We just don't know at the moment. And then, of course, there's new or worsened breathlessness. And pulmonary embolism really comes first and foremost here. So again, this is a very large study, over 2,000 individuals that was published in JAMA also at the end of last year, and they followed people up to 90 days post-discharge. They found that there was a risk of pulmonary thromboembolic disease. So in this sample, 1.3% post-discharge, 16 PEs, 18 DVTs, and interestingly, two portal vein thromboses. Most of these events do occur within the first 30 days of discharge. They were certainly more likely if you had a history of previous PE or DVT and if you were sicker when you were in hospital. anticoagulation at the time of discharge substantially reduced the risk of this, and that's hardly any surprise. So new onset breathlessness in that phase following recent discharge, it is reasonable to think of PE. Again, we would advise you to assess them in the same way that you assess someone with pulmonary embolism now. You assess what the pre-test clinical probability is that they may have a PE using something such as the Wells score. A D-dimer this far down the track is probably still helpful. Early on, yes, it may still be positive following their acute admission, as it often is during acute COVID-19. But of course, if it's negative, that's a helpful thing. Those who've got a low pretest clinical probability with a negative D-dimer probably do not need imaging. If you've got a high probability, positive D-dimer, get on imaging them, diagnose their pulmonary emboli and treat it. And of course, there's still going to be that group in the middle. Use your clinical judgment and investigate as appropriate. But cardiovascular disease is really something that we need to think about here. And this is a nice overview of a large US veteran study, over 150,000 people. Definitely have to thank Donald Trump for the large sample size here, who went and got COVID-19 and what happened to them 12 months after their acute admission. So just a reminder, myocarditis occurs with acute COVID-19, incredibly rare following RNA vaccines, but not that uncommon post-COVID. A hazard ratio here of over 5. But more importantly, the prevalence was much higher in things such as ischemic heart disease. A hazard ratio of 1.6 for acute myocardial infarction, similar for angina, atrial fibrillation was increased as well, and also cerebrovascular disease. This is a real problem. This is up to 12 months after their hospital admission. So think very hard about patients with new onset chest pain, particularly chest pain on exertion and palpitations. And it's more than reasonable where that's indicated to go ahead and start investigating, particularly for ischemic heart disease and for atrial fibrillation. There are other issues as well that may well include, of course, deconditioning, physical inactivity will all lead to tachycardia and palpitation. Rarely we are seeing cases of postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome or POTS. And of course, significant psychological distress can be tied up with all of these things. So very, very briefly, the UK is probably ahead of all of us in terms of organising what they're going to do for their post-acute COVID care. This has come from the Manchester NHS group. They're taking this approach, which I think has a lot of sense and is not dissimilar to what we're doing now with acute management of COVID. So tier one is anybody after their acute illness. Well, if they've got relatively mild symptoms, having sufficient online support, information which is patient-centered, and a self-management approach to triage and to manage ongoing symptoms until they resolve or go back to normal. In those who don't, moving on, of course, to primary care to get an assessment and to get investigations. And then you've got a hierarchy as people get sicker or their symptoms are more significant as to escalating it up into secondary care in this tier three, tier four role here, where those who've got the most significant impairment are being seen by multidisciplinary teams and discussed and moving into more high-end rehabilitation in the long term. So all of these tiers can exist and need to be exist with clear referral pathways. Of course, in the UK, they are really funding this in a big way. That's 5 to 15%, they think, with COVID will have long COVID syndrome. They had a much higher proportion of people unwell, though, during the Alpha and the Delta waves before they were able to vaccinate people. A lot of money is being put into this, and a lot of organisation is going ahead. They've set this up fairly clearly, both with primary care and in secondary care. They're taking the approach of looking at physiology, doing questionnaires like the Yorkshire screening, and getting on and doing screening tests, as I mentioned, such as chest x-ray and lung function. And the hospital clinics, again, they're trying to centralize this to have areas where primary care know where and how to refer. So that's really it from me. We're still in evolution to try and put this all in place at the moment. I like the approach where we've got this tiered sort of response, but it's going to have to be a real collaborative effort between all of us, identifying patients, making sure people are self-managing, getting the resources out there to them, getting them seen and screened in primary care, and then a small number of individuals may well need to go on and have more intensive support. All of these people did all of the work in putting together this clinical practice guideline so far. So thank you very much.
Well, thanks very much, Peter. That's fantastic. We've actually had a couple of questions I might just throw to you straight away. Dan Ewald has asked about the connection between some of the clinical clusterings. So particularly, you might see his question there. Do the same people have the fog and dysautonomia and unexplained pain, et cetera, that have the altered lung function, or are they different groups?
The answer is yes. So, so look, there's a lot of variability here, and there is a lot of crossover between these sorts of things. And I think it gets fairly complicated. For people who've got very severe acute respiratory impairment, I think it's very hard sometimes to differentiate some of those neurological symptoms where they're not so well defined. And they can be overrepresented and will reflect things such as physiological impairment because of gas exchange problems, as well as cardiovascular impairment. So I think it gets fairly complicated. So the short answer is absolutely there is overlap, but similarly, there are distinct clusterings that appear as well, with some people having a more predominance of some of these neurological symptoms without having a lot of physiological or direct involvement of their lungs. And that certainly is a cohort. That group with those neurological symptoms tended to have milder acute disease. These are not, there's no hard and fast rules here.
Okay. And just a technical epidemiological question. Those hazard ratios, what was the control group? You know?
Oh, so they, yeah. So pre-existent disease and people who didn't have COVID. So the US Veterans Association have got a really long standing database which really records things quite well. So I can't recall off the top of my head. I think it was the 12 months prior to COVID that they used as their baseline to look to see what the excess disease prevalence was going to be. And they also had a group who did not have COVID. So they had two control groups in order to be able to get and derive those hazard ratios.
Mm. Another question which came into my mind has come from Fiona. You said that you direct people on that pathway to community exercise physiologists on the basis of severity. Is there a measure of severity? How do you judge which direction they go in terms of severity?
So again, there's no hard and fast rules here. What we are going to recommend in New South Wales is trying to make some assessments there. And I guess there's always going to, particularly for symptoms such as breathlessness and impairment in terms of ADLs, there's always going to be a degree of subjective assessment there. Or you could claw that clinical judgment, and both is probably pretty reasonable. Some of the questionnaires do, I think, give you a nicer approach to assessing that severity. The dyspnea 12 is a nice questionnaire to use and to think about this. But at the end of the day, people who score in domains where they talk about breathlessness, which is moderate to severe, or is impacting upon their ability to carry out their ADLs, but they all really tick the box for saying this is a very severe group of individuals. If that's the case, and they're in this early phase, there is some evidence, it's not fantastic, but some evidence that our conventional approaches with pulmonary rehabilitation can be helpful. Not completely, but helpful and improving outcomes, at least in the short term. So that's probably a place to start.
That's great. Look, there are a couple of other questions, but I think if you don't mind, we might move on to the next presentation, and I'll make a note of those other questions, and we'll certainly try and get them in the Q&A session. So I'm going to hand over to Megan now. Thanks very much, Peter.
Sorry about that, unmute. Hello, thank you very much for asking me to speak. My name's Megan Rees. I'm speaking from Wurundjeri land in Melbourne, and I acknowledge the traditional owners as well. So I'm going to speak to you a little bit first about some updates from the Australian COVID-19 Task Force. I'm delighted to see Dan Ewart, who's one of my panelists on the living guidelines, and just tell you a little bit about how the living guidelines work. There's certainly been some new initiatives in the living guidelines. So it's a quite complex structure of essentially a living evidence model. So it's essentially a rolling meta-analysis where new research is incorporated and assessed in a standardised way, and so that clinical questions can be asked and evidence-based data can be updated regularly. You can access it as a web portal, and there's several new initiatives that occur within the COVID-19's Evidence Task Force webpage that I think you'll find very useful. These include flowcharts, so determining what sequence of investigations or treatments you might want to give to a patient who has COVID-19 under different situations. There's also some risk calculators to determine who might be needing specific therapies or might need referral to hospital. And there's also a number of new patient engagement tools. So when you use your various search engine and look for COVID-19 living guidelines or the Evidence Task Force, this is the first web page that you encounter, and you can see there's lots of information, including things about the task force, the guidelines, how to get in touch. One can submit new questions that you'd like the task force to address if there's a clinical question that you'd like to approach, and then you can look down here either to the living guidelines, so the exact data and recommendations for different treatments, clinical flow charts that can tell you an approach to looking after a patient, and then various topics under review. If you look at the section on post-COVID-19, we have a flow chart for care of patients with post-COVID-19. You'll notice that this was most recently updated in November of last year, and I know there's some ongoing work in the background, and some new data will be coming in this section of the living guidelines. But essentially, you can get information about the background to post-COVID, how one might want to start approaching a patient with post-COVID, and different strategies and the evidence that is based on. Where there's some newer data is in some of the treatments, and I'll just go through the example of one treatment for acute COVID, which is inhaled steroids, so that you can get an idea of how the guidelines work and how you can use those in your own practice. So much of the data that's our guideline is based on for inhaled corticosteroids in acute COVID is based on this one paper, and I'll just give you some information about this paper, and you can see how we go from looking at an individual paper to putting a guideline together. So this was quite a large study that occurred in the UK. It's called the Principal Trial, and it was a randomised, controlled but open label, so there was no placebo arm, adaptive platform trial to see whether inhaled budesonide was helpful in patients with acute COVID-19. Now that slide probably does not reproduce very well, but you can see they actually recruited very large numbers of patients, both into a control arm with no placebo and an active arm where patients received inhaled budesonide. And they measured various outcomes, including breathlessness, patient symptoms, where the patients presented to the emergency department. And this is some of the outcomes. You can see that people who had budesonide rather than inhaled, rather than usual care, had an improvement in their recovery. Their time to recovery was faster, and that was statistically significant. But as you can imagine, it's an uncontrolled study, and people know that if they've received the treatment arm or if they haven't. So you have to think about how you would weight that in clinical practice. There was a number of secondary outcomes measured, including time to recovery. We can see this is very significant. The illness severity at various days, and it was all better for budesonide. Self-reported contact with healthcare was also improved. But the one that we thought was probably most relevant to clinical practice, and hopefully this will... I might have to scroll to the next page, is oxygen administration. So we felt this was a relatively unbiased data point. And so our group panel thought this was likely to be significant, that patients who received inhaled budesonide were less likely to need to go on to have oxygen administered. But some of these other parameters that were measured that turned out to be quite statistically significant may not in clinical practice be clinically significant, because patients knew which arm they were in, essentially. So what happens when the data comes together? So that was the largest study that this data was based on, but there was a number of other studies that were pulled together, and they were analysed by the statistical support team as part of the COVID-19 task force. And that data is put together, and then a group of experts get together and make a recommendation. And so looking at all the data, most of which was from this principal trial, the group's consensus was that we would, as a conditional recommendation, consider using inhaled corticosteroids within 14 days of symptom onset for adults with COVID-19 who do not require oxygen. So once they require oxygen, there's other therapies that are recommended. And these patients have one or more risk factors for disease progression, because that was the group that was recruited into the principal study. If you want to look into the data a little bit further on this website, you can click onto the actual results. So if you click on this research evidence tab, and you can see all these various parameters that are brought to the statistics that the recommendations are based around. And you can see various things like absolute effect size, and you can see there's really not much difference in all-cause mortality. So that although there were four fewer in the intervention group, the confidence intervals, 95% confidence intervals, crossed the midline. So that was not really regarded as significant. But when we looked at supplemental oxygen, you can see that in the intervention group, there was over here on the right, there's significantly less people needed supplemental oxygen, and that these confidence intervals actually did not cross the midline. So there was a moderate recommendation to use budesonide. So you can click down a little bit further and you get a summary tab on what the data is based on, so you can see, and these references are also highlighted. So if you want to read the original papers yourself, you can trawl through that way, or you can use the digested statistics. Additionally, there is a number of features that are now included on the living guidelines to help in your discussions with patients, including this is, I think, quite a useful visual scale. So this is to actually give patients a sense of perspective, maybe even for ourselves as well, of what an effect size means. So in grey, we have all the people that might have been given treatment. And if you were on in the control arm, if you did not receive budesonide, 93% of them needed to go on and require supplemental oxygen. So you can see the vast majority of people did not need to have supplemental oxygen anyway. But if you gave inhaled budesonide, these additional people in orange on this diagram did not need inhaled corticosteroids. So sometimes that can be quite a useful tool to talk about with your patients when you're trying to sort of talk about effect size and how useful a medication is. Now, interestingly, the UK Clinical Evidence Task Force panel recommended against using inhaled corticosteroids, and it actually was based on the same data as our Australian group. And I think this highlights what the role of the expert panel is. So in Australia, we have an expert panel of various clinicians, and they always make sure they select a variety of states as well as craft groups, including infectious diseases, respiratory medicine, clinical pharmacologists, general practice, and they also make sure that there is a gender balance on the panel. And we weigh the evidence within the local context to provide this evidence-based recommendation. So on balance, our Australian group felt that the benefit from inhaled budesonide was significant and that the downside of using inhaled corticosteroids would not be significant. So we made a moderate recommendation to use the inhaled corticosteroids. If the evidence is lacking either way, but we feel that the impacts of a decision are quite significant and clinicians would like some guidance, but we don't have any direct evidence to base it on, the Living Guidelines Group can make a consensus recommendation, and that is clearly stated to be a consensus recommendation, so clinical expert opinion rather than based on data. And I think people can find that quite useful as well. So what are some of the common presenting symptoms for patients who have post COVID-19 illness presenting to primary care? Well, the commonest things are breathlessness, exertional hypoxia, particularly in the first few months after COVID infection, and cough. And then fatigue is also very significant. Many people, in fact, I'd say the vast majority of people initially after their COVID-19 infection have a lot of fatigue. And the recovery is generally slow but steady. Lethargy and lack of endurance is significant. And feeding into that as well is sleep and circadian rhythm disturbance. And many patients tell us that their sleep has worsened and does appear that their sleep architecture is somewhat disrupted. It's a little bit lighter, but additionally, their circadian rhythm, so when they want to be awake and when they want to be asleep, is quite disturbed. Neurological symptoms are much less common, but quite distressing when patients have them. In particular, patients talk of brain fog or this sense that they can't really concentrate and focus. Anosmia or a lack of sense of smell is quite prominent early on, and even altered smell and taste sensations. So people quite often talk about smells that would normally be quite benign or quite pleasant being quite pungent and quite distressing. I had one patient who found the smell of jasmine quite strong and almost nauseating, sort of had become a metallic sort of smell or taste to him. Specific neuropathies do occur, but they're extremely rare, and we haven't seen enough to sort of cluster them into any one group, but they can occur. So at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, we established a post-COVID model of care quite early in the pandemic, and this began towards the end of 2020. Unfortunately, at our hospital, we had a large number of ward outbreaks and a lot of staff became infected with COVID-19. So there was really quite a great demand for post-COVID services amongst our staff, as well as many of our patients. And my predecessor and still staff member of my department, Professor Lou Irving, was a great champion of this, setting up this post-COVID clinic, which is really quite novel in its space. And the idea of our post-COVID clinic, which was a little bit different to some of the more systematic approaches that occurred in the UK and elsewhere, where people sort of took set time points and did a standard lot of investigations, is that we wanted to really explore what the patient experience was and have a sort of focused approach on symptoms. Because we were all in new territory, it was a new condition that none of us had ever looked after before, we really wanted it to be something we could learn from and learn from each other. And we felt that a breadth of opinions in the room was going to be very helpful. So we like it to be thought of as a learning community with a symptom-focused approach. So we had nearly 500 appointments have occurred since that time it was initiated up until January of this year. It's built up very gradually with a big rise after our Delta outbreak late last year, and we're continuing to have increased referrals to our service. We did an initial audit in August of last year. So if you think about the timing of that, this is mostly patients who would have had the alpha strains of COVID-19, so just before Delta started. But within these patients, many of them had abnormal lung function tests. So 27% had an abnormal respiratory function test. Particularly gas transfer. So this is DLCO, so how well carbon monoxide transfers across from the airways into the bloodstream. And that is a marker of how well oxygen can get into the bloodstream. So that was the most common abnormality that people had. Within our clinic, 45% were discharged within 6 months of their initial illness, and that proportion is actually gradually increasing over time. And I think a little bit of that is us being more confident about the natural trajectory of post-COVID illness and feeling more confident to let patients be discharged. And our clinic, as I said, was initially half healthcare workers. That proportion is now reduced a little bit as unfortunately COVID has spread further out in the community. Occasionally, we have discovered concomitant disease. One of the more serious things we've occasionally uncovered is interstitial lung disease, and particularly patients who had interstitial lung disease before they had COVID, we found have a much more severe COVID illness and longer lasting sequelae. We've occasionally turned up some benign tumours and very rarely anemia as a cause of breathlessness and fatigue, but it has occurred. And mental health problems are not universal, but not uncommon either. So our clinic sees patients at various times during the week, but we have a weekly multidisciplinary meeting that occurs for about an hour. It's chaired by Professor Lou Irving. Respiratory physicians are present, but we also have general practitioners on our group, a psychiatrist and a sleep neurologist. We particularly find our general practitioners on the multidisciplinary link up very helpful because they've got a great perspective on what resources are available in community. Often they have looked after the patients in the long term, and so they've got a better idea of the background for their patients. We also have a physiotherapist, and we have an exercise physiologist. We have a music therapist who is going to be starting up a singing for COVID group. Singing for lungs has been a very successful initiative in the UK, particularly for patients with COPD, improves their lung function and their quality of life and their breathlessness scores. So we're hoping the same thing will occur for post-COVID. We have a neuropsychologist who's been very helpful for us doing cognitive assessments for our patients with brain fog. Interestingly, amongst our series, we have not found any dementias or progressive neurocognitive diseases, but we have had slight reductions in performance and quickness of the neurocognitive testing, but all that would be consistent with a fatigue-like pattern. And that can be remarkably reassuring to the patient to know that they're not going crazy, they're not developing dementia, and that really it's the fatigue that's driving this sort of sense of focus. We also have a nurse coordinator, which is invaluable and a great resource for our patients. And we are linked in with some research projects and have an immunology researcher sitting in our clinic most weeks. And it's great to have that biology perspective on what we do. So what have we found to be effective interventions? Listening to the patients and validating their symptoms is incredibly important. And there have been a number of studies both here and overseas where patients feel that they were looked after for their acute COVID illness and then somewhat abandoned by the healthcare system, and that people think that their symptoms are all in their mind and that it's really not a real problem. We don't think that's the case. We think that people have had a really severe viral illness. COVID is certainly worse than the flu. Most people feel unwell, definitely for 4 weeks, often out to 12 weeks. And there are a group of people that go beyond the 12 weeks. So listening and validating their symptoms is really important. We do targeted investigations to specific symptoms of concern. And as Peter mentioned, we do target investigations for ischemic heart disease, post-COVID pulmonary embolism, although I must say we haven't seen any beyond the six-week mark from COVID, and excluding other illnesses. We also manage expectations. I think particularly our young and active people, we had a large number of sports people and very active, busy people who want their lives to continue to be very busy and want to get back to normal as quickly as possible. Just the knowledge that it is normal for this to take many months to resolve reassures them, and they can sort of switch their mindset around to the why has this gone wrong to me, to the recovery trajectory, and that's helpful. We've found graded exercise and pacing activity very useful, and our exercise physiologists have been a great resource during this time. And they have been at this stage tailoring exercise programs to individuals, but the general principle is to just reduce the exercise that they have been doing somewhat, but looking to build endurance and longevity. We do also try and do general health things, optimising nutrition. A number of patients have lost weight. There's an average 5 kilo weight loss in the first few months after COVID, but does tend to recover. And reducing smoking is obviously very important to increasing lung health. Insomnia management is particularly important. A lot of these patients receive dexamethasone during their inpatient stay at an equivalent dose of 37.5 milligrams of prednisolone for up to 10 days. And that in itself can be very disruptive to your sleep, as we think there's also a direct viral effect to disrupt sleep architecture. But also often they're at home, their routines have changed, they might have been working from home and having children schooled at home as well, which doesn't help. But trying to get back into a normal circadian rhythm is really important. And that's quite hard to do, particularly if you're feeling quite fatigued. You might want to watch a movie or so very late into the night. But the usual advice of avoiding screens at nighttime, getting some gentle exercise in natural daylight in the mornings seems to help people get back into a normal circadian rhythm. And we also measure and document their functional progress. And so we often do lung function tests, particularly a 6-minute walk test over time, and patients can see that they're on a recovery trajectory, and that does help going forward. And the last thing to note is that vaccination improves symptoms for post and for long COVID. And we have quite robust data for this. So the first is a study from Israel, which showed that vaccination with two doses reduced the likelihood of symptoms of long COVID in a population-wide study of people after they'd become infected. And also, so they'd had their vaccines before their infection. But also, patients who already developed long COVID and had a subsequent vaccination also had a reduced symptoms at 3 months down the track compared to those that didn't go on to have a subsequent vaccination. So that's really quite reassuring. If patients are due for any booster shots, some of them are often very anxious that a vaccination might worsen their symptoms, but actually the reverse is true. So just a reminder that that's the current page for post-COVID-19 care on the national guidelines, and it will be updated soon. And I think I've run over time. My apologies.
Thanks, Megan. Fabulous to get that overview. And a lot of questions coming through, some of which you've already answered, for instance, with regard to sleep and so on. There's a lot of questions about resources, particularly around, for instance, getting a hold of respiratory rehab or even care in chronic fatigue. It's going to be challenging in general practice. You've got a limited number of referrals under a care plan. The outpatients tend to be pretty overwhelmed or non-existent. Is there any interesting to see the resources being thrown at it in the UK? Is there any thought that this is going to require extra resourcing that you're aware of? Any thoughts about the whole resourcing issue and access issue for care for these patients?
So I don't know, but it is an election year, so one would hope so. There's certainly a significant, it's a significant problem. And even if it doesn't have a strong mortality associated, there's an enormous cost to the community. These are people who are not returning to work. We've certainly chosen to invest in it heavily at the Royal Melbourne Hospital because many of them were our staff and that we were having trouble returning people to work, as well as it being the right thing to do. So I think if governments look at it that way, hopefully they will consider resourcing it a little more thoroughly. But it is expensive, but I think there's a tiered system, and I think the New South Wales approach to having a tiered system is probably the way to go, and we're certainly developing that in Victoria as well, where there will be some web-based or online resources for patients who can self-manage, who are in the milder groups, and then you can have things at the local level and then the more complex tertiary referrals for the patients who are a little bit more complex.
Mm-hmm. A question about people who are immunosuppressed. are they more at risk, less at risk? What's the impact of long COVID in those people?
I don't know. Do you want to do this one, Peter, or me?
I mean, yeah, look, all I could say is that it would depend upon how unwell they were to begin with, probably. And people who are immunosuppressed are at greater risk of more significant acute disease. It is likely to translate into them having more problems afterwards. But that's probably the simple answer. Whether it goes beyond that is difficult to say.
We haven't seen that pattern yet in our clinics, I must say. In terms of acute illness, particularly with this Omicron wave, we have had a lot more immunosuppressed people than we did for Delta. It's hard to know exactly what that means. You know, is it just that we've had greater vaccination? Would the people who are known to be immunosuppressed, you know, isolating more at home? Or is there something about the immunosuppression that means the vaccination isn't quite as effective for them? We're still unraveling that. I think there's a lot of ongoing research in that area.
Okay. What about reinfections? More likely to get long COVID? Smita Shah asks, if you get any information there.
Well, again, it probably is the opposite, in that the second time round you should have a less severe acute illness, unless there's something else wrong with you.
And what about a fourth booster? If you've got long COVID, any sign that a fourth booster might help?
I don't think there's any clear evidence on that. There was certainly some chatter when vaccination started that people's long COVID symptoms improved. But I haven't seen anything particularly good that actually clearly demonstrates that was the case, either published yet.
Interesting question here about the trial you mentioned, Megan. Is there any way to pick the people who will benefit from inhaled budesonide?
Oh, so in that, with acute COVID, patients who are at risk of severe disease were recruited into that trial. So they were...
They're already selected.
So having one or more COVID, they were already selected. So we haven't... I don't believe we have data for the general population. So it's mostly people who are at risk.
Although the Stoic trial was actually the first, the smaller phase two trial. It being a smaller trial, actually did have a bigger effect, but earlier on in the pandemic as well, with less access to vaccination. It could work the opposite way, in that with recovery, of course, they took an older population, and in whom inhaled steroids might just not cut it. And we see that with other things like remdesivir and even dexamethasone and baricitinib. Once you're impaired, other things begin to trump some of our interventions. Inhaled corticosteroids may, in fact, work better for those who are not going to get very sick to begin with, interestingly. That's obviously a hypothesis.
All right, well, look, guys, it's 6:58 on Thursday evening, and we've had our hour. It's been absolutely fascinating, and I think the response from the crew shows that there's a lot of interest and a lot of need to know more about this. We really appreciate the work that you guys are doing and you sharing with us information as it's emerging. I want to thank you all for joining us for the evening's webcast. I know you found value in it. And we hope what we've discussed will be helpful as you support patients through their post-COVID journeys. I can tell you that if you've asked questions and they haven't been answered personally, I'm assured by the Lung Foundation that they will get back to you personally with those answers. I want to thank our fantastic panel, Professor Wark and Associate Professor Rees, for sharing the knowledge that you've got and the insightful presentations and telling us about the resources that are available. Before you close your window, once we sign off, an evaluation survey will appear on the screen, and we'd appreciate your feedback so that we can provide relevant contact and the best experience for you and the primary care community at future events. Thank you. Thank you for attending. Thank you for your attention, and take care of yourselves out there on the front line. Thank you and good night.